message that we're recording. Hey, LA Progressive community. This is Dick Price and Sharon Kyle of the LA Progressive coming to you again. Just as a reminder, you can hear us on Spotify and on Apple Music and Amazon Music and a whole bunch of other places, as well as YouTube. So we'd like to encourage you to please subscribe and please like, share, and all of the other things that are offered on the various platforms where you're reading or hearing this. So, Dick, who's our guest today?
Yeah, we're delighted to once again have our dear friend, Peter Larman, a retired minister who we worked with here in L.A. for a number of years, and now he's escaped to Rhode Island. And he recently came out with an article called "A National Security Advisor's Secret Source," where he imagines a conversation with foreign policy guru Jake Sullivan, who was deep in the Obama administration, deep in the Biden administration. You imagine a conversation between him and Satan, where at the heart of it, you wonder if the United States backing Israel's invasion of, is it Jordan or Lebanon or Syria, whatever it is today, might not work out in the long run. How did you come to that conclusion?
Well, first, this is, I use the term, it's a conceit, it's an imaginary thing, but sometimes you kind of have to go out of the realm of straight, you know, essay narration to try to capture something. And what I'm trying to say here is that, what country is being invaded today? It's the Jake Sullivans of the world, the people who will tell you without hesitation, they're much smarter than you. And they have access to far more information than you have. It's the Jake Sullivans of this world who drive our country to mad misadventures again and again and again. And this lockstep alliance with Israel cannot be good for the United States of America by any measure. It's good for one person, Benjamin Netanyahu, who will be in jail if he's not prime minister. And so, you know, he has to ride on the support of his extreme right cabinet people in his coalition. I'm exhausted by ranting about Israel and Netanyahu because they're going to do what they're going to do. I'm trying to focus more on what are we thinking or are we thinking when we let all these Jake Sullivan. So, yes, it's an imaginary conversation between Sullivan and his satanic majesty, in which the Lord of the Underworld says, slaps Jake around a little bit and says, come on, this is kind of naive. I'm more evil than you. You don't even know how to do your evil right.
Yeah.
You know, killing people is not a concern of mine, but you don't seem to have a long-term strategy here by tying yourselves so closely to an aggressor state. So yeah, that's the conceit, and then the other thing about this is it kills me. It kills me. It stops me cold every time. While all this militarism persists and persists and persists with no end in sight, we're losing the environmental moment. We are absolutely losing it. And in fact, the ordnance and everything related to the military is a tremendous accelerant to climate change all over the globe. How can the country that styles itself the stable democracy and, you know, leader of the free world, how can that country expect anything but catastrophe if its own posture is hegemonic, militaristic all the time? People see us in a way that we don't see it. And it's not a pretty sight.
So I was trying to look for the names of a couple of gentlemen, social scientists who conducted a research project trying to find out how often policy is enacted in favor of the ways that the people, the constituents, want this policy to be written and put in place. And I can't find their names, but it was about 10 years ago. And what they determined was that the average person has a snowball's chance in hell of having their wishes played out by their representatives, and that really it's just the deep-pocketed individuals who have an inordinate amount of control in the United States and the United States government, who have a seat at the table. They're the ones that are pulling all the strings. So, you know, I just don't, when we look at what's happening in Israel, how many of us feel like we have a chance of changing that?
Sharon, I believe you're suggesting that capitalism and imperialism are joined in some fashion. And I'm shocked to hear that coming from your lips.
I think that capitalism is antithetical to democracy. What they determined, these two researchers, is that we live in an oligarchy. So what the people want or what the people need is the last thing. I was listening to a report about the Second Amendment and how something on the order of 92% of Americans want to have some kind of sane gun control legislation put in place. 92%, and we get nothing. What kind of democracy is this?
Well, it's a failed democracy, and it's a democracy that can't long persist on these terms. I want to add another layer, which of course is the misinformation layer. So there's what the people want, and what I believe Marx would call false consciousness. That is to say, what they think they want because it's fed to them by these same corporate entities, right? The manipulators. So yeah, it is grim. But our job, yours, mine, our friends, our job is to continuously say this path is fated to fail. It's a path of destruction, and we insist on more transparency. We don't. I mean, we're on the cusp of this big election. Everybody agrees that it's the highest stakes election possibly in our lifetime. The idea that we need to turn away from war and destruction is not even in the conversation at the moment. Not really. I'm not saying there's no difference between these candidates, but I am saying that there's no foreseeable break with the hegemonic, I believe the term was most lethal military force. Well, that's not even in question with the United States. I mean, I was astonished that just in terms of the country's self-respect, that Netanyahu does all these things. He does not consult the White House. The White House admits that they're not consulted. He thumbs their nose at us continuously, although, you know, it's he bites the hands that feed him. And we go along with this. I mean, that part is kind of insane. You know, the degree of insult that he delivers all the time, as though he's telling us, I have a lock on your politics that you don't know about.
Yeah, I mean, I would quarrel with the thing is we go along with it. We don't go along with it.
We protest through diplomatic channel. I mean, what we don't do.
Well, recently Netanyahu spoke to Congress, and all the Congress people except for Rashida Tlaib were leaping to their feet and thunderously applauding every word he said. And then you turn to what is supposedly liberal media, and all they can say is, well, the world started October 5th, and it's tattooed on their forehead like a prisoner up at San Quentin is Israel has a right to defend itself. End of conversation. And I don't think a lot of thinking people are buying any of it. But as Sharon says, what can we do about it?
Yeah.
Well, at a minimum, we can continue to make noise. We can engage with our friends, which can sometimes be difficult about this. It can sometimes be difficult because, a lot of liberals are, they're liberal to a point, but they don't want to go into this because they think it's none of their business. And this geopolitical stuff is beyond their comprehension. I just want for a minute to think about the Jake Sullivan. So I have a dishonor roll of people who have had that role over time. Everybody remembers Cheney and Rumsfeld, right? I think it's hard to forget Henry Kissinger. And by the way, is he still alive? I think he is.
No, he just died.
He died this year.
Hard to believe. Hard to believe that he's
Didn't
dead.
Didn't you hear the sigh of relief? The worldwide sigh of, oh, thank God.
No, he's gone. So.
Too late, too late, too late. And then there's this whole dishonor roll of the Georges. So, you know, George Shultz, the Georges during the Vietnam period, George Ball. I'm cheating a little bit, but who can forget McGeorge Bundy? And then, you know, before them, there was George Kennan. And going way back, and I don't think people will recognize this name, but they should. There was a person named George Mann, M-A-H-O-N, who was the foreign policy advisor to none other than Theodore Roosevelt, and to some extent to Theodore's cousin, Franklin, who was all about dominance. You know, it's like we're ready for dominance. He came up in the era of the Spanish-American War. So we've been doing this for a long, long time, trying to move our little chess pieces around the globe. And of course, the cost is pretty well concealed from the American people. Nobody ever actually calls attention to the cost. There's the Defense Appropriation Act. Nobody pays attention to that. And that's only, may I say, the tip of the iceberg in terms of the total cost of this. The veterans who come back shattered, hey, there's not that many of them anymore. We try to increase their benefits, pacify them to some degree. It's a mess. It is the empire style, but the empire style, as Satan tells Jake, is really not that sustainable.
No, it isn't. It isn't. And it increasingly touches more and more people because of our need to dominate the world. There was a time, and I think that time is still here, but it's getting worse because the middle class is disappearing. But those who were in the lower rungs of our class hierarchy were the ones who paid the ultimate price in serving in these wars and, you know, being drafted and so forth. You know, Dick, of course, did serve, and Dick was wounded, but Dick volunteered. He was at Columbia at the time, and he had an automatic deferment. But he chose to go in. And I am very familiar with the cost that he paid. There are things that piss me off still to this day that he deals with and has not been compensated for. It really makes me angry when I see.
Well, what do I deal with?
Well, you need to go to the dentist, for example, right? You would think that that is something that some kind of medical coverage that he would get. It pisses me off that Donald Trump gets it. Why should Donald Bone Spurs Trump be covered in ways that my husband is not? My husband was wounded twice. So that's all I'll say on that.
There's a handful of political leaders now, mainly younger, mainly people of color, who are in fact talking about the costs of war, costs with an S, that is to say, not just the official price tag, but the multiplier effects. And of course, you're right that Northrop Grumman and Lockheed Martin and Boeing and the rest of them are in there pitching all the time. But I think maybe the time is coming, because things that cannot go on will not go on. I really do believe that there comes that time.
Yeah, I hope that's true. I mean, last night we had the scintillating debate between Corporal Vance and Sergeant Major Walsh, where the war was barely mentioned. And I'm sure that neither of them can really campaign on opposition to the war, because nothing will really happen. Now, I'm going to support Kamala Harris, even though currently she's kind of running to be Mitt Romney. But I have the hope that she's not so dug into her positions that when she gets in office, that she'll make some moves. Because, you know, we can't wash our hands of what's happening in Israel. What's happening in Israel is happening with our bombs, paid for by our taxpayers, taxes, that could have gone to the 60,000 homeless people living on the streets of Los Angeles and hundreds of thousands around the country. But we would much rather play this power game. And I'm sure part of it is that the Jake Sullivans in the world, it's a pretty flashy life to be, you know, in charge of war and wearing suits and flying around the country and ignoring people that really need the help. But that's my little rant. And I'm not suffering that much from being a Vietnam vet.
He'll always say that.
Despite what she says.
So Peter, tell us more about this imaginary conversation that you came up with between Jake Sullivan and Satan. When did these thoughts come to mind, and when did you pen paper?
I was, may I say this, out of the country for 11 days. I was walking around Scotland and I was on a news fast. I was not absorbing the news. I was with a small group of people. And if anybody mentioned, for example, Donald J. Trump, they had to buy a round. and we enforced it. And then I came back into this political, you know, space and was barraged immediately. You know, you can't open your phone without getting 25 hysterical messages from people about this, that, and the other thing. I think I was triggered by something that that Sullivan actually said yesterday. I think I heard a snatch of, because he does talk to the media all the time, about, wow, this is great. This is really, really great. You know, now we're going to smack Iran. And I thought to myself, huh? You know, we're going to smack Iran. I know that's been an obsession for a long time. I know the United States cannot acknowledge its guilty conscience about overthrowing the legitimate government of Iran back in the 50s in order to put in the Shah, right, who was then overthrown. And that's like, how dare they? How dare they overthrow our puppet,
right,
and interfere with the free flow of oil to, you know, our refineries? I mean, maybe the thing that gets me almost more than anything is that most of my fellow countrymen and your fellow country people have no awareness of any of that backdrop. There's nothing about you know, our little dirty fingers over all of these catastrophes, which we then seem to think just came, you know, were the spawn of Satan. What I'm trying to say is that Satan wouldn't be that stupid.
You know, when Dick and I first got together, he would often tell me that people are not as smart as I think they are. And I would often tell him that white people are a whole lot more racist than you think they are. And now, that was like more than 20 years ago that we would have this constant debate. Now I have to concede he was right. And he has to concede I was right.
That's lovely. That's lovely. And that's how things should work. So yeah, I mean, I wish I were. I'm not like the New Yorker's Paul Rudnick, who comes up with these fabulous, you know, little humorous one page things, or Andy Borowitz. I mean, I'm not at that level at all. But I thought I have to think about Jake Sullivan checking in with not the president, but with his actual control, the Lord of the Underworld.
So for our listeners, I was thinking it might be a good idea to just read maybe just one exchange between Sullivan and his satanic majesty. Do you have it in front of you, Peter?
No, but if you would do it, I would be grateful. I trust you for dramatic reading purposes.
Okay, so Sullivan says, "Good Christ, what a thrilling day. Now we've got Iranian missiles raining down on Israel. There are sure to be plenty of bloody dead and wounded Israeli bodies to show to U.S. media and to prove once and for all how mercilessly the Iranians and their proxies are. Think about it. We finally have direct war with Iran in our sights. I think I deserve a drink." His Satanic Majesty responds, "First, Jake, I will thank you not to refer to any good Christ. Second, you get even more incoherent when you drink. Third, as I have tried to say to every goddamn one of you for decades, Israeli ground invasions, occupations of Lebanon have never and never will end well. 1982? Let's see. That one lasted 18 years. And what did Israel get out of it? 2006? That lasted just a few weeks. But again, what did Israel get for it? Bunkus, I believe, is the correct term. You Americans and Israelis with dicks for brains never seem to take the long view as I do. So I just wanted to give our listening audience a little bit of what is posted on the laprogressive.com, an article written by Peter Larman and entitled, I'm trying to get to the title here, A National Security Advisor's Secret Source. And it's really a satirical piece written by Peter Larman, but I think that it really rings true, sadly.
I thank you for posting it. And I must say, my prediction that Sullivan and his comrades would be able to exhibit Israeli bodies, that didn't come true, because I think there's not a single Israeli casualty. They deflected all these missiles, wave after wave, with the Iron Dome system and with our warships actively participating, standing by. But it's not over. I wish it was over, because of course, now Netanyahu says, of course we need, even though no Israelis died, a West Bank resident died, now we have to have massive retaliation. So stay tuned, world, because this is, I think they're going for the wider war.
Yeah, I think I read that 8 Israeli soldiers died in the invasion, when they recently invaded Lebanon.
Yeah. But not in this missile barrage.
Right. Yeah. But it's like we're playing Russian roulette. I mean, honest to God, Israel is now attacking half the countries in the Middle East. And they got a lot of people and a lot of money, and they know, they read the book. They know that the United States is behind it all or complicit. And it just worries the heck out of a person.
Well, it's the military industrial complex. I mean, basically, the United States propped up by a war economy. When you talk about all of the multi-billions and billions of dollars that have been spent and given over to Israel, just think of how many people are employed on that right here alone, right here in Southern California, at places like Boeing and Hughes and all of these huge military contracts. And that's one of the things that really makes me sad, is that people go to work every day. They work on these contracts. They make a significant, nice yearly income, live in suburbia. And I wonder, do they ever think about how that, the work that they're doing, how that supports these awful things that we hear that are going on there in the Middle East?
Well, I can answer that a little bit first, because I worked for an aerospace company years ago. There wasn't a war going on at the time, but we were brewing up to one. And I know that some of the other scientists that I talked to, they didn't like it, that the fact that what we were doing was building missiles that could go kill people. But as Sharon says, that allowed them to live in a very nice part of town.
They had mortgages to pay. Go ahead, Peter.
It's cognitive dissonance. The ones who actually have breakdowns are the people who sit in rooms in our country and operate these drone strikes. They tend to break down, as they should. I mean, it would be inhuman not to have a response to that. I want us to maybe end with, just spiritually, revenge, payback, it's not getting us anywhere. It just doesn't. I know that it's, I know that it goes back to, the dawn of human consciousness. But we believe that, I mean, I believe, and I know you believe, that humanity has learned some things along the way. The biggest lesson that the path of violence is a no-win path for the perpetrator along with the victim. We haven't learned that. So sometimes I just ask people, just live with this for a little bit. Just live with this in your own life, but also in our collective life. Is this working? Is this working? Somebody does me a little bit of dirt. I spent a lot of time trying to figure out how to do them dirt. I've spent many of my precious moments in this life thinking about things like that. Even though the better part of me knows that's insane. That's a form of insanity. I am not saying that people shouldn't defend themselves. I'm not saying that. But I'm saying that I'm going to hit you harder. In fact, I'm going to destroy your capacity to hit me. That has never worked. Do they think by killing this Nasrallah guy using, I think, something like 80 of these 2,000-pound bombs, you know, and killing all these other people in the, you know, do they think that Hezbollah is not going to come up with somebody else? I mean, really? How smart are they, really? It's just, it's moral insanity, but it's also sort of insanity. On that bright note, I have to say I love you. I'm grateful for what you do. I will never be your humor columnist, but once in a while I might throw you a curveball.
Well, we love you too, Peter, and we're so thankful that you are always willing to share your wisdom. You know, you sat there and uttered off some things that happened in history, and I'm thinking, golly, this guy's a walking encyclopedia. And you know, we don't learn these things in school now. Some of the stuff, like the Teddy Roosevelt discussion of the guy that worked for Teddy Roosevelt. Of course, you don't remember that, but some of the stuff you actually do remember. And I certainly appreciate your willingness to share all of this information for the readers and the listeners of the LA Progressive.
It's mutual. It's mutual. And better days ahead.
Thank you, Peter.
Thank you. So long.
Thank you for sticking around. If you like the LA Progressive content and the discussions we have here, please consider clicking the subscribe button below and also give us a thumbs up. That helps to grow our audience by feeding the algorithm, which helps to get this content in front of more eyes. Thanks for stopping by. We really appreciate your support.